Hello guys, I welcome you to this video lecture on BSc 2 Physics course. In the last week, we discussed about semiconductors. So basically, first we discuss about what are materials, how materials can be classified as gases, liquids, and solids. Then we say that the solids are classified as metal, semiconductor, and insulator. And we discuss about the band diagram of this particular material. So in case of metals, the valence band, and we say that the valence band and the conduction band, they overlap. So this is my valence band, this is the conduction band, and they overlap. And because of that, there are availability of electron even at 0 degree Kelvin, and hence it is a very good conductor of electricity even at 0 degree Celsius, 0 degree Kelvin. In case of semiconductors, there is a small gap between valence band and conduction band. So this is valence band, this is conduction band. And there is a gap between this valence band and conduction band, and this gap is known as the band gap or the forbidden gap. And hence, in order to make electron move from valence band into conduction band, you require some amount of energy, and hence this is not good conductor at low temperature but good conductor at high temperature. In case of insulators, there is a large gap between valence band and conduction band, and hence insulators are bad conductor at all the temperature. So that's what we discuss in the last week. Then we discuss about semiconductors, and we say that in case of semiconductor, we have two types of semiconductor: intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. In case of intrinsic semiconductors, these are very pure semiconductor material, and you have number of electron is equal to number of hole. In extrinsic semiconductor, these are a doped semiconductor material, and here the number of electron and number of holes are not equal. That's the basic definition. So this is very pure, and these are dope, generally dope material. So, and then we discuss about the what is acceptor energy level in case of extrinsic semiconductor material. What is acceptor energy level, what is donor energy level, and we discuss about what is Fermi energy level, and what is going to happen when the acceptor impurity, these are impurity, what is going to happen if we change the impurity concentration, what is going to happen to these acceptor and donor impurity levels. Similarly, the effect of temperature on Fermi energy, effect of temperature on Fermi energy level is also discussed. So if I want to tell you the gist of last lecture, the gist will be something like this. The first thing, important thing, is that in order for a conduction, we need electron in conduction band or hole in valence band. If I have, and this can be achieved by exciting an electron from valence band into conduction band, so you require some amount of energy. This is some energy which is greater than the band gap, greater than or equal to the band gap energy. Then electron from valence band will go into conduction band, so you have an electron in conduction band and you have a hole in valence band. Both this electron and this hole conduct electricity. Now electron conduct electricity by directly moving. So if I look at the microscopic picture, what I'm going to get something like this. I have positive immobilized ions in a solid, and I have free electrons. Suppose this is a free electron, and when you apply electricity, this is negative terminal, this is positive terminal. When you apply electricity, this electron will move from negative terminal to positive terminal. However, in case of holes, to show you the transport of hole, I need to show this particular structure. So this is silicon, 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 silicon. Something like this structure is there. And suppose I have applied a positive potential to this particular electric field to this particular structure. So there is a battery connected over here. So this is a negative terminal and positive terminal. Now, say when I say that the electron make a transition from valence band to conduction band, what actually happening is that, suppose I'm talking about this particular silicon atom or this particular silicon atom. Okay, so there are four electrons. One is over here, one is over here, one is over here, and one is over here. This is covalent bond. So one electron from this silicon and another electron from this silicon, they form a covalent bond. So in each bond there are two electrons. Okay. Now when I say that electron make a transition from valence band into conduction band, what actually happens is that this electron over here, it get detached from this silicon atom and it becomes free. Now this electron can move. So when this electron get detached, there is a creation of hole. So I have created a hole by exciting an electron from valence band into conduction band. Now because of the electric field, this electron can move from negative potential to positive potential. So this electron will be moving in this direction. However, look at this particular hole now. Since there is a vacancy over here, what can happen? Electron from another neighboring silicon atom can jump at this particular position and this hole can be get filled, and I have created a new hole over here. Then next electron can jump at this particular position and new hole can be created over here. Similarly, next silicon electron from next silicon atom can jump over here and a hole is created. Now if you look carefully, electron is moving from negative terminal to positive terminals and the hole is moving from positive terminal to negative. Initially the hole was here, then it went over here, then it went over here, then it went over here. So both electrons and hole conduct electricity. Now electron moves directly from negative terminal to positive terminal. On the other hand, hole moves by jumping from atom to atom. This particular process of jumping is known as hopping process. And this hole moves from positive terminal to negative terminal of a battery, right? So both electron and hole conduct electricity. Now you can consider this conduction to be something like this. Suppose in a class you are sitting something like this. This is a class over here and there are rows of students, something like this. So this is one bench, second bench, third bench, something like this. Now a person sitting at this particular position wants something to be transferred, let's say a chocolate, to be transferred to this particular person over here, right? Now how this can be done? This person can get up from its position and it can go and directly deliver the good. Okay, so whatever good that was over here is transferred directly at this particular position without intervention of any other students. So this is my electronic transfer, electron current. On the other hand, the same thing can be done in a little bit different manner. So let me use different color for that, so forth. So what can happen? This person can transport the good over here to this particular person. This particular person can transport the good to this particular person. This can transport to this person, and this can be transferred to this person. So suppose I have a chocolate, and this chocolate is to be transported from this person to this person. Then what he can do, he can give that particular chocolate over here. Then from here, it can be given to this particular person. From this particular person, it can be given to the next person. From the next person to the ultimate position. Okay. So again, I have transported the good. So this green thing, which make utilization of all the resources available, is current due to holes. In this way, electron and hole conduct electricity. Both conduct electricity. Now in semiconductors, the current will be equal to current because of electrons plus current because of hole. So the total current flowing in semiconductor is partially because of electrons and partially because of holes. Okay. We discussed that in case of intrinsic semiconductor, we said that okay, number of electrons will be equal to number of holes, and hence current due to electron will be exactly equal to current due to hole. And I can write the total current will be 2 times current due to electron. This is for intrinsic semiconductor. On the other hand, for extrinsic semiconductors, number of electrons is not equal to number of holes. And hence, I have 2 types of extrinsic semiconductor. I have N-type semiconductor and I have P-type semiconductor. What happened in P-type semiconductor? What is the relation between number of electron and number of hole? Which one is larger? Since this is a N-type material, electrons will be larger because electron has a negative charge. So N over here. So number of electrons will be larger. And in P-type material, what will be larger? Since hole has a positive charge, so in P-type material, P for positive, hole will be larger, right? And hence current because of electron will be larger as compared to current because of hole in case of n-type material, and in case of p-type material current because of electron will be smaller as compared to current because of hole. Now in general, in n-type material, number of electrons will be much larger than number of holes. Hence I can say that the current conduction in case of n-type material is only because of electron. And similarly, in p-type material, the current conduction is only because of holes. And that's why we say that the electrons, since only electrons are conducting current over here, we say that in case of n-type material, electrons are majority charge carrier. Similarly, in case of p-type material, since the current conducted is largely because of holes, we say that holes are majority charge carriers. Got this particular thing? In case of n-type materials, electrons are majority charge carriers. In case of p-type material, holes are majority charge carriers. So please note this particular thing down. So in n-type, electrons are majority charge carriers. In p-type, holes are majority charge carriers. Now since electrons are majority charge carriers is n-type material, and in holes are majority charge carriers in p-type material, in n-type material the minority charge carriers will be holes in case of n-type material. In case of p-type materials, what will be minority charge carriers? Minority charge carriers will be electrons for p-type material. So let me write that over here. So suppose this is n-type material, this is p-type material, then in n-type material I have number of electron is equal to larger than number of holes, and in p-type material I have number of hole larger than number of electron. Then what is the majority charge carriers? Majority charge carriers will be in n-type material electron, in p-type material hole. This is majority charge carriers. What is minority charge carriers? Minority charge carriers in case of n-type material is hole, in case of p-type material is electron. This is minority charge carriers. And the current will be, because of electrons, so the current will be current because of electrons in n-type material, and in p-type material the current will be because of number of holes. So maximum amount of current will be flowing because of electrons and in n-type material, and maximum current will be flowing because of holes in p-type materials. And whatever current because of hole, this will be very small in case of n-type material, and in case of p-type material current because of electrons will be very small. So whatever current because of minority charge carriers, this is current because of minority charge carriers. So whatever current because of minority charge carriers, it's very very small, and it is also known as leakage current. So this is termed as leakage current. So do you understand this particular thing? Then we say that both these p-type materials and n-type materials, they are neutral. This is very important. This is also neutral. So if I have a piece of, let's say, p-type material with me, so this is a piece of p-type material, then over here there will be large numbers of holes available. So let me call these are the holes which can conduct electricity. But if I look overall this material, this complete material, then number of protons in this particular material, that is the positive charges, will be exactly equal to number of electrons. We discussed this, right? And hence this is a neutral material. Similarly, n-type material, there are large numbers of free electrons which can conduct electricity, but here also the number of protons for the whole material is equal to number of electrons, and this is also neutral material. So it is something like a metal. In case of metals, what we have? We have large number of free electrons which can conduct electricity, but this is a neutral material. Why? Because the total number of protons and total number of electrons will be exactly equal. These electrons can just conduct electricity. Similarly, over here the holes can conduct electricity. Over here the electron can conduct electricity. Now since these electrons conduct electricity directly, so let's look over here. Since these electrons can conduct electricity directly, and these holes can conduct electricity by what is known as hopping process, which one is easier to conduct electricity? Which one is easier to move? Obviously the electron, because it is directly moving. So it's very easier for electron to move as compared to hole. And in a material, if I apply electric field to a material, suppose I applied some electric field, so this is electric, by attaching a battery I have applied an electric field, and if this, because of this electric field, this electron gains some velocity, then the measure of ease with which a charge carrier कैन बी मूव्ड. सो कितने इजीली मैं चार्ज कैरियर्स को मूव कर सकता हूँ बाय अप्लाइंग इलेक्ट्रिसिटी इज कॉल्ड एज मोबिलिटी. सो मोबिलिटी का डेफिनेशन है, यू डिफाइन मोबिलिटी एज वेलोसिटी गेन डिवाइडेड बाय इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड. सो दिस इज वेलोसिटी, दिस इज इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड. इट गिव्स यू हाउ इजीली यू कैन मूव अ इलेक्ट्रॉन बाय अप्लाइंग और एनी चार्ज कैरियर्स बाय अप्लाइंग इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड. ओके, एंड सिंस इलेक्ट्रॉन डायरेक्टली मूव, इट्स वेरी इजियर फॉर इलेक्ट्रॉन टू मूव. इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट फॉर होल टू मूव सिंस होल्स आर कंडक्टिंग द इलेक्ट्रिसिटी बाय हॉपिंग, राइट. सो इन जनरल इफ आई हैव अ मटेरियल, इन दैट मटेरियल मोबिलिटी ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन विल ऑलवेज बी ग्रेटर दैन मोबिलिटी ऑफ होल. It's very easier for us to move electron as compared to holes. Now let's look at this mobility in a more detail. So let's first we are going to look at what is known as electrical conductivity. So if I have a material with me, something like this, suppose this is a material that I have. And if I connect a electric voltage over here and I want to find out what is the resistivity of this material. By resistivity I am coming to that particular part. So let's suppose I want to measure the properties of this material. So what you are going to do, you are going to apply some voltage and you are going to measure what is the amount of current and you are going to apply Ohm's law V is equal to IR to find what is the resistance. So this will give me, if I know what is the applied voltage, what is the current flowing through this material, I can find out the resistance is equal to V by I, isn't it? Now this resistance is equal to rho L by A. This is the formula for resistance, where rho is the resistivity of a material, L is length of the material. So, यहां से यहां तक कितना लेंथ है उसका, एंड ए इज अ क्रॉस सेक्शनल एरिया. ए इज अ क्रॉस सेक्शनल एरिया, राइट. सो इफ आई टेक अ मटेरियल समथिंग लाइक दिस, सपोज दिस इज माई मटेरियल. And if I apply something like this, I apply some potential to this particular face and this particular face, something like this, then I'm going to consider this to be my length. And the cross-sectional area will be the area of this particular face or this particular face, right? So this is my area and rho will be the resistivity. Now why I want this resistivity? Because if you look at this particular equation, R is equal to rho L by A, it depends on length of the material. If I change the length of the material, the resistance is going to change. If I change the area of the material, the resistance is going to change. But the resistivity is independent of dimension of the material, right? And hence it will be the intrinsic property of a material. It does not depend on the external size and shape of the material. So that's why I am interested in resistivity. So if I put that in this Ohm's law equation, V is equal to IR. So what I am going to get, V is equal to I rho L by A. And I can rearrange this equation something like this. V, this L I am bringing on this particular side, divided by L is equal to I by A into rho. So what is V by L? From your electrostatics, you know that V by L is the electric field. And I by A is known as J, which is current density. So basically it is amount of current flowing per unit area into rho. Now, if I rearrange this equation, I'm going to get 1 over rho is equal to J divided by E. And this 1 over rho, the reciprocal of resistivity, is known as conductivity. So 1 over rho is equal to sigma. Sigma is my conductivity. So sigma will be equal to J divided by E, current density divided by the applied electric field. What we are going to do now, we are going to look at this particular thing, and we are going to find J. What is J? So now suppose if I have a material something like this, and this is the material. So kuch shape ka material hai ye, something like this suppose, and there are n number of, let's say, charge carriers, koi bhi charge carriers per unit volume. So I have this small n is my charge carrier density. Then if the charge carriers has a velocity, let me call it as, so when you apply electricity, because of the collision of the electron with the ions, the electrons or the charge carriers move with a constant velocity, and that velocity is known as drift velocity. If Vd is drift velocity, then the charge carriers moves a distance Vd in 1 second. That's what it means. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to look at what is the amount of current flowing per unit time. I kitna flow ho raha hai wo mujhe find out karna hai, iska value kitna hai wo mujhe find out karna hai. So I want to find out what is this current. So in order to find this current, I know that in 1 second the charge carrier, let's call the charge carriers to be, let's suppose this is electron, the electron moves a distance. How much distance it is moving? So we have seen over here, if Vd is the drift velocity, then a distance moved is in 1 second is Vd. So this electron moves a distance of Vd. Okay, the next question is then, what is the volume moved in 1 second? So if this is distance, if I multiply it by cross sectional area, I am going to get volume. So Vd into A, this is the volume sweat in 1 second. So the next question is then, what is the number of charges moved in 1 second? 1 second mein kitne charge honge? So that would be volume density multiplied by volume. So volume density N multiplied by volume Vd into A, this will give me number of charge carriers. So basically this is number of electron per unit volume into volume. So volume get cancel, and I am going to get number of electron moved in 1 second. Correct? Okay. So once I know what is the charge moved in 1 second, number of charge moved in 1 second, I can find out what is the total charge moved in 1 second. So for that, what I need to do, I need to just multiply this particular number of charge moved, this particular thing, with charge on a charge particle. So the charge on the charge particle is E. So I am going to get, and what is this total charge moved in 1 second? So this will be amount of charge per second, per unit time. So basically this is my current. So I will be equal to NEVD by A, and hence I can rewrite this as I by A is equal to NEVD. What is this? This is equal to J, and we have over here sigma is equal to J by E. So hence sigma is equal to J by E. This equation will become NEVD by A. And what is this? It has to be. And what is this? VD by E. We defined mobility, how easily it is we are able to move the charge carriers by applying electric field, which is defined as velocity divided by the applied electric field. So this sigma will becomes mu E N. This is what sigma is, mu E N. So what I have is this sigma is equal to mu E N, and this is the electrical conductivity of a material. So this is electrical conductivity. Now please note this thing. So what we have J is equal to NEVD, right? So in case of semiconductors, as we said, both electrons and holes conduct electricity, correct? So I said that the total current in case of semiconductor will be current because of hole plus current because of electron. So if I want to write current over here, this implies that current I will be equal to NEVD into A. So the current will be equal to I will be equal to NEV electron into area plus, let me give a small suffix, N is the number of electrons, into E VH into A. So what I have over here, so the current will become E into A NE VE plus, this will be NH, NH, VH. This is my total current, and I can put this A on this particular side. So J will be equal to E times number of electrons into velocity of electrons plus number of holes into velocity of hole. Right? And hence the electrical conductivity sigma, which is equal to J by E, will be equal to sigma will be equal to E into NEVE plus E into NHVH divided by E. So if I redo it, this V by E, I'm going to call it as mu E, which is the mobility of electrons, so that will be mu E N plus this VH by E will be mu H. So mu H E N H. So this is number of electrons, this is number of hole. So this is what electrical conductivity is. The electrical conductivity is also because of number of holes and electrons. And since the mobility of hole, we said that mobility of hole is less than mobility of electron. That since this is the case,
the electrical conductivity of electron will be larger as compared to electrical conductivity because of hole. So you need to remember that this sigma is equal to the singular way to remember it is equal to mu en men. This is the spelling of men. If you want to find out what is the electrical conductivity of electron, put mobility of electron and number of electron. If you want to find out what is the mobility of hole, put mobility because of hole into number of holes. And this is not only number of holes, this is number of holes and E number of electron per unit volume. So density of electrons. And NH is number of holes per unit. This is what is known as electrical conductivity. Now let's discuss about how to measure this particular electrical conductivity. So this is electrical conductivity. How we can do that experimentally? That's what we are going to do. The experiment to measure the electrical conductivity, mobility, and all the electrical parameters is Hall effect. It is also known as Hall probe experiment. It is the experiment which can tell you the electrical conductivity, it can also tell you what is the mobility of electron or charge carriers, mobility of charge carriers. It can also tell you charge carrier concentration, so number of electron, E and NH, number of electron or number of holes per unit volume. It will also tells you, this is one of the few experiments that can tell you the polarity of charge carriers. Okay, so whether electrons are conducting the current in semiconductor or holes are conducting the current in semiconductor, that can be found from this Hall effect. So let's look at what is Hall effect. So in for that, let's consider, suppose I have a piece of material over here and I applied an electric field to this particular material. So because of that, what's going to happen? The charge carriers, let's first consider positive charge carriers I'm considering, so hole I'm considering. So the positive charge carriers will move from positive potential to negative potential. Now what will happen if I applied a magnetic field in this direction? So the magnetic field is going inside this particular page. What will happen? Now because of the magnetic field and electric field, a force will be acting on this particular charge carriers. So the force acting on the charge carriers will be equal to Q. Q is the charge on the charge carriers. B cross B. This is the field because of the magnetic field, where V is the velocity of the charge carriers and B is the applied magnetic field. Q is the charge carrier, charge on the charge carrier. Okay? So the since this is a vector product V cross B, it will be the force acting is also a vector quantity. It will be perpendicular to both the direction of velocity and direction of magnetic field. Now look over here. So if it is something like this, suppose I have applied velocity in this direction, this is what velocity is, and the magnetic field is applied in this particular direction, then the force will be perpendicular to both this and this. So the force will be acting along this particular direction. And how you are going to do that? You need to hold your right hand fingers from the first vector to second vector. So the first vector is velocity vector. So you need to hold your fingers from V towards B, and the thumb will indicate the direction of resultant vector. So this is the direction of force. So what's going to happen if I applied magnetic field in this particular direction? There will be a force on this particular positive charge in upward direction, and instead of moving in a straight line direction, So in the absence of magnetic field, what is going to happen? The charge carrier will move in a straight line direction, something like this, more or less. But because of the magnetic field, when I start applying, so without B. But when I apply a magnetic field, there will be a force acting in upward direction, and the charge carrier, instead of moving in a straight line direction, it will start moving in upward direction, something like this. Right? And after some time, so with B, after some time, what's going to happen is that the charge carriers will see a boundary of the material and it cannot move in this particular direction any further, and it will just start dragging along the surface. So after some time, what's going to happen? There will be a accumulation of positive charges over here, right? What is going to happen to the negative charge? Since negative charge is moving in this particular direction, right, the velocity will be negative, so there will be accumulated the force acting on the electron. So this will be a force acting on positive charge, and the force acting on negative charge will be in the downward direction. So there will be a accumulation of negative charges. Why? Because there is a surface of charge field, say, upar nahi ja sakte. So what I have over here is, if I apply perpendicular electric and magnetic field. So देखो यहाँ पे इस direction में मैंने electric field apply की थी और इस perpendicular direction में magnetic field apply की थी. So instead of B, I can simply write E because the velocity electric field की वजह से आ रही है वहाँ पे. So if I apply perpendicular electric and magnetic field to a material, to the remaining surface, जो जिस सरफेस पे सपोज कि मेरा मटेरियल था, सो लेट मी राइट इट समथिंग लाइक दिस, राइट समथिंग लाइक दिस. तो इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड मैंने इस सरफेस पे और इस सरफेस पे अप्लाई की है. सो आई हैव कनेक्टेड दिस टू सरफेसेस बाय सम बैटरी. सो इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड अप्लाई की हुई है एंड द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड आई हैव अप्लाइड बिटवीन लेट्स से this surface and the back surface, right? So ये जो सामने वाला front face and back face, इस पे क्या apply किया हुआ है? Magnetic field apply किया हुआ है. So कौन से दो surfaces बाकी है अभी मेरे? I have top and bottom surface remaining. On this top and bottom surface, there will be accumulation of charges. So on the top surface, if this is the case, on top surface you will have positive charge accumulated, on the bottom surface you will have negative charge accumulated. And because of this accumulation of charges, so I have something like this. I have positive charges accumulated over here and I have negative charges accumulated over here, and if I connect this particular terminal and this terminal, because of this positive charges there will be a positive potential created over here, because of this negative charges there will be a negative potential created at this particular point, and if I connect a voltmeter over here I will get a potential difference. So there will be a voltage generated. This particular process of generating voltage is known by application of perpendicular electric and magnetic field is known as Hall effect. So what is Hall effect? So the definition of Hall effect is something like this. If perpendicular electric and magnetic fields are applied to two perpendicular faces, of a material, then voltage will be generated across remaining two surfaces. And this voltage that is generated is known as Hall voltage. So in the next lecture we will discuss about this Hall voltage, what is Hall coefficient and how we can measure the electrical conductivity, we can measure electrical conductivity, mobility, charge carrier concentration and polarity of charge carrier. So how we can measure this particular property using this, that's what we are going to discuss in the next lecture. So thank you for your time. See you in the next lecture.